Fucking other people, but I don't like to be touched. Mm-hmm. And some people also identifies strongly that they like being touched, but they don't like being touched. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right.
If they
are attracted to you back.
Okay. Can we do it in one sentence, maybe? Mm-hmm. So I can repeat it back. So it's when you still experience attraction, but you don't feel the need to tell that person or have that attraction reciprocated.
Okay.
For example, I say I'm brave romantic. Because I'm mostly libro romantic, but sometimes I'm andro romantic.
An andro romantic.
It's attracted to men.
Okay.
I'm gender queer, so I can't use hetero.
Okay.
Or bi. I have to use andro down in the portfolio.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Anybody else confused about that?
Yes.
Immediately forget and have to ask you later anyway.
Listen to me.
homosexual, but there are some different kinds of examples. Like, for me, I'm a gray because I rarely experience sexual attraction. For me, it's instead of it being the norm, it's the exception to the rule. And for some people, they experience sexual attraction, but they don't have a sex drive. And then there are some that enjoy and desire sex under very limited circumstances. Are there any other examples you guys can think of?
Some horrible circumstances that happened to you. So if you're asexual because of something, I would not say you're asexual. You know, you may, I don't know. It's like saying that you're forced into being your sexual orientation. Something happened and made you become this way. I don't know if I'm explaining myself properly, but you know, if you have, you know, sexual
trauma,
yeah, or along those lines, and you just shut yourself down, and it is a sexual process that you choose not to.
Right, but it's choice, yeah. Not necessarily orientation.
Yeah, but again, I don't want to say that sexual orientation.
Hang out with that.
Of course not.
But yeah, that's a really good point. Because on the other side, I often hear that people think, oh, you're only asexual because somebody did something bad to you, which is not the case. You're totally fine and happy and wonderful just how you are without any bad thing happening.
Okay, my name is Holland, and I prefer female pronouns. But I think that your sexual or asexual identity is separate from your trauma or past, whatever.
Right. Right. You can have both.
Yeah.
My name is Warren. I'm female pronouns. I'm a researcher on asexuality. I work with Lori Goddard in Vancouver. One of the things that we did for my master's research was looking at biological markers of asexuality. Mm-hmm. And just there's some indications for, like, gay men, for example, that they're more likely to be left-handed. And we found that asexual people were more likely to be left-handed, even more than gay people. So, which is an indication that there might be some sort of prenatal hormone thing for some people, which was a really interesting finding. Just going back to whether people are born that way or whatever. So, just something to say.
Yeah, I just want to look at more of the earlier points raised. And I say, you know, asexuality is primarily a phenomenon. It's described for people who feel certain ways. I don't think that asexuality makes any assumption about causes. Like, I mean, if you're asexual due to trauma, then, you know, that's still asexual. I mean, that's fine. Or if you're asexual because you've always been that way, you've always been born that way. If it's genetic, then no, it's genetic. At least I don't. But, I mean, I would say that it's important to distinguish the phenomenon of asexuality from, you know, your asexual because of a certain thing that happened in the past.
Hi, my name is Stella. I prefer her. He doesn't matter gender. I was just wondering, what if you have a high libido? You can sometimes experience sexual attraction, but, and you have had sexual contact, but there's something in your brain that's just not connecting with your body, that you actually have to force yourself to connect between, you know, it's a body-mind thing, but the body is working, the mind is not, and you have to force yourself into it. And if you don't have to, you don't even have to play the pipe, you don't have to do anything. It's something more like a chore for the brain. Would that be considered still a brain?
Sure.
Obviously, it's a little tea.
Well, it's interesting because some people think, like, oh, I'm asexual and I have sex, thus I must be gray asexual. But that's not necessarily true. You can be asexual, not experience sexual attraction whatsoever, and still have sex for various reasons.
And still have a good time doing it. Yeah.
Yeah, well, and even if you enjoy it, have a good time doing it, even if at that moment your brain is able to connect with the body to perform such an act, if it's taken away from you, you know, you regret the thing and you don't care. So that was sort of all over for
you.
So.
You can identify whichever label feels
good. That seems to be it.
We're not here to tell you what it is.
Okay, so. Thank you.
Did I
get a
hand over there?
Yes.
Are you going to me?
Were you raising your hand?
Yes.
Oh.
I suppose the distinction that must be made between sexual attraction and sex drive, they are different.
Yes.
So if you have a sex drive, but you just don't feel like acting on it ever, except for maybe on yourself, I suppose, you can still identify as asexual, no problem.
Yes. Thank you. A sex drive is, it's better to explain it with food analogies. A sex drive is kind of like being hungry. It's like you want to eat. Sexual attraction is basically what you want to eat. So it's like if you don't experience sexual attraction, you're hungry, but you really don't want to eat anything that's in the house.
reduction is reduction without having the male and female partner. So I'll be trying to use it to asexual situation, right? And we use different meanings of the tale in terms of asexual that finds out stuff. Don't be often on the label.
So that is a biological, in terms of biology in science, that is used, that is accurate. Asexual reproduction is a thing. That is a thing.
Yeah.
That's not us. So Michael Storms, or no, before that. Was someone else that I know that in the 80s a man named Michael Storms wrote a research paper that moved a binary classification of how much you were attracted to the same sex or the opposite sex into a how much you are at Kinsey. No, I'm not thinking Kinsey. I'm not thinking Kinsey had a binary. Michael Storms had a double. I am talking about a 100-square. Where if you were attracted to the same sex or the opposite sex, and how much. So asexuals over here, bisexuals over here, and then each of them. And so it wasn't necessarily, as a prefix, the word a, meaning not, whatever is following it, worked for asexual reproduction in biological science, but it also worked for his research paper, and then it, along with many other terms, were adopted by people in the internet asexual identity world, and this one became very prominent. Something to say for
you?
Well,
yes.
Because
my
youngest
said, I always guess that.
So,
your plan? Yes! No, it's just like that one word, reproduction, just makes the world difference.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Rick Key. So in these myriad of terms, do you have a term that is uniquely specified for those who have no drive, have no interest, have no attraction?
Well, that would be if he means no romantic attraction. Because some people, if they don't have a sex drive, they might identify as non-libidoist. So you could just tell people, like, I just don't have interest.
You could just be asexual. You could do that. If you... Whatever works best for you. And you can use it for romantic or sexual. Anything you can apply to sexual, you can also apply to romantic. Aromantic, demiromantic.
But if you make it asexual, then that then builds upon the term because of all these other permeations of it.
You just have to add as many terms as you need. For example, you can be polyamorous, a great asexual, that will define you on your romantic level, on the sexual level, and your
at some point, you should probably just have a conversation.
Can I just make a request? Maybe he, him, his. Can I just make a request that people speak up and face the majority of the room or something? Because it's really, really hard to hear up here. And we're only hearing about half the conversation.
Okay. Good. Now.
No,
I
have to move down.
Good evening.
Just to end the question of like where asexual could have come from, would be like A, B, not. So like not sexual, like to think like atheist, not. So A is not sexual.
Hi, my name is Etta. Is she her? I have a question about sexual attraction. Can you just apply for us?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That is actually
very hard. Sorry, I think you asked them to define.
Yeah, she
just
say
that.
Yeah.
Definition was sexual attraction.
Did it really?
sexologist. So,
so
we define within our language of sexology, sexual attraction, of course, being subjective for each person, but it's the desire, the wanting of the desire and the wanting for some kind of behavior that is subjective to what sexual means to that person or that other, that individual or that person or persons that they are desiring. So it's the wanting.
Michael, I should introduce myself first time, by the way. Michael, pronouns he. I'm going to just contribute one possible definition. It's not perfect, but what I kind of like is directed libido. So not libido, but directed libido. So libido directed at somebody in particular. So if you have a libido, but it's not directed at any person in particular, that's not sexual attraction, and you can be asexual.
It's like we were talking about the hunger. So you can be hungry for something, and if you're asexual, you wouldn't have something that you're particularly hungry for. But if you're experiencing sexual attraction, it's like that cheesecake. That cheesecake. Where confusion comes in. Because you can be aromantic and even be in like a romantic relationship, but you
I, male pronouns, maybe just non-platonic or romantic, non-platonic, non-sexual.
How do you spell platonic?
Conversation that happens.
boundaries. They don't care who they date, who their friends are. You walk into a very gray zone in terms of romantic relationship or platonic relationship with them. They're just what they call free loving, sometimes irresponsible, sometimes not, but clear and straightforward openness, but that free of mind.
I think communication is the most important part of any relationship, romantic, friendship, platonic, family, anybody. I think communication is the most important skill that anybody can develop.
That's what
it doesn't mean it's easy, no.
Does anybody want to break into smaller groups and talk to people next to you as opposed to listening to us talk a little?
You have so much personality.
We can do a few options with that. We could have different sections of the room tackle different topics, or you can break up into your own little groups and talk about whatever you would want to talk about. So how about if you don't have a default, you can pick what is closest to you in the front of the board. So like you're here, but if you want to choose a different group, that's fine. So maybe groups of like